From the Savoy Hotel in London, firing line with William F. Buckley, Jr.
Malcolm Muggeridge is a British institution, like the Home Office, against whose importunities he rails, like the monarchy, which he considers an extravagant anachronism. To imagine his counterpart in America, one would have to roll together Art Buchwald, Paul Goodman, Dwight MacDonald, and maybe just a touch of Simeon Stylites. That, in the opinion of some people, is altogether too many roles for one man to play. And accordingly, you will find here and there someone who believes that Mr. Muggeridge has lacerated the marginal book idea or institution. Usually it turns out that there is a close connection between the victim of one of Mr. Muggeridge's essays and the critic of Mr. Muggeridge, for instance, idolatry. But Mr. Muggeridge has survived. He survived criticizing Stalin during the 40s, the Queen during the 50s, and President Kennedy during the 60s. He is clearly imperishable. He calls himself a journalist, and here in England, that is a designation that one associates with Addison and Steele, with Walter Badgett. It is what Chesterton insisted on calling himself. He worked first for the Manchester Guardian, which sent him to Moscow. That proved the worst trial the communists had since the mobilization of the White Army. Then he went to Calcutta for the New Statesman, then Washington for the Telegraph. Then he was editor of Punch, and in the past dozen years, he has freelanced, writing the book reviews for Esquire, doing television and radio, lecturing, writing books, and accepting briefly the rectorship of Edinburgh University. He calls himself a man of the left, for reasons we shall explore in a discussion of the culture of the left. His apostasies from the left are, however, so numerous as to leave him a member of the left in the same sense that, say, Bishop Pike is a member of the Christian Church. I should like to begin by asking Mr. Muggeridge, how did he hope to retain his credentials as a liberal after writing a year or so ago that history would prove that Mrs. Roosevelt did more damage than Benito Mussolini? Mr. Muggeridge.
Well, Bill, I think you must distinguish between being a member of the left and being a liberal. I regard liberalism as the great disease of our society. And when I said that that people like Mrs. Roosevelt, admirable though they were in intention, would be seen to have done more damage than people like Hitler and Stalin, I meant precisely that. Because Hitler and Stalin got a lot of people killed and precipitated a great war, but they are now discredited. But liberalism, which has been the dominant philosophy in the most influential and even powerful nations of the West, continues to thrive despite the fact that every time it's been applied, the consequences have been disastrous.
You therefore distinguish between liberalism and leftism.
Left, yes, indeed.
And what, for instance, would be some of the critical distinctions between those two?
Well, I think when I say that I am a man of the left, I mean by that I am instinctively against authority and on the side, or hope that I would always wish to be on the side, on the weaker side.
Well, why would that make you distinctively a leftist?
Well, because I think that is what is good in the left position is precisely that. What's bad is its connection and sometimes identification with what you in America would call a liberal view of life. Mm-hmm. That's the bad side. The good side is an instinctive, almost chivalrous feeling that you should be on the side of the weak.
Well, would you say that there is a curious, then, congruity between the left, as defined in England, and the conservative, as defined in America, who is singularly the opponent of authority, especially state authority?
Yes, I've always had a considerable sympathy with the right in America, a considerable sympathy with you, as a matter of fact, Bill, whom I read fairly faithfully. I even had a considerable sympathy, I think I must have been almost alone in England in that, a considerable sympathy with Goldwater as a human being and as a thinker. I remember being asked to explain this once in America, And it was impossible to explain it on philosophical grounds and the circumstances. So I contented myself with saying that I'd seen that Goldwater, that 1,200 American psychiatrists had said that Goldwater was potty, and therefore he was my man.
But a lot of people would, of course, consider this a perverse, wouldn't they?
They would, yeah. Because I think the great curse of the... If I were asked to point to one thing, which I think is the absolute curse of the 20th century, it is thinking in categories, rather than thinking. Therefore, you say, a person belongs to the left. That means he must be in favor of abortion, he must love homosexuals. You see, all those things, which have nothing whatever to do with the position.
Well, why did you identify yourself as, quote, of the left, if you shrink from these categories?
Well, because I meant by that something quite definite, which to me is something admirable, and which would correct, it's the thing I like to say over to myself, even, to make absolutely sure that one would never allow oneself to become caught up in any kind of association with authority, with those who are powerful.
Well, then, you are of the left, and you viewed, do I understand that you view the British left as having as its most striking common denominator the resistance of authority?
No, not at all. Uh-huh. I think that in its tradition in which I was brought up, what I admire in it is precisely that. But of course, the trouble with the left is that it occasionally has to form governments. Mm-hmm. And as soon as it forms a government...
It's ruined.
Ruined. I mean, you get a man like Wilson. I mean, he sets the left back by about 1,000 years. Just by being prime minister.
Well, this may make him a considerable social philanthropist.
It may. Well, he's got to have something to be philanthropic with, though. That's Wilson's trouble at the moment.
Yes,
shortage of cash in the till, Bill.
Yes, yes, that's right. But to the extent, of course, that he discredits a highly discreditable view of social organization, then he can be useful, right?
He can be useful to authority.
For instance, it can be said that Hitler was useful in discrediting anti-Semitism.
In that sort of way,
yeah.
Yes.
Well, would you say then that really your definition of the left is rather antique, at least by current standards, it being generally understood?
Well, I think it would
that
be
the left seeks centralist solutions, and therefore the authority of the state.
Yes, I would. I absolutely agree. I mean, my attitude to the left, I belong in a kind of a loose way to the Anglican Church. I could also
loose as hell,
as you say. I could also say that I was a very passionate Christian. You see,
lowercase.
As I grow older, more and more, this becomes to preoccupy me. But you would say, well, then how can you say anything in favor of the Anglican Church? I don't say anything in favor of the Anglican Church, except that remotely, initially, in the Book of Common Prayer, it has a vague Christian orientation, which has been totally lost as the result of the activities of successive archbishops, particularly including the present one.
You find the Bible sort of onomatopoetically pleasing?
I find the Gospels and the Epistles very pleasing indeed. The Old Testament is something different.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you said fairly recently that Christian dogmas are to me completely incredible. I can't possibly and could never believe in them.
I didn't actually say incredible, Bill. It's not your fault. We always get it wrongly reported, as I'm sure you know from
your book.
Political activities. I said they were not. You want to bet on that?
Yes.
All right.
But don't.
No. No, what I said was that they are intrinsically unimportant to me.
In other words, you don't find them incredible.
Well, I might find them incredible, I might not, but what strikes me about them is that they seem to me to be unimportant.
Uh-huh. Well, the reason I'm anxious to press this point is because there is a considerable interest and has been historically in America on the point of whether a true leftism calls for emancipation from spiritual and religious dogmas. But I see, especially since you are a precisionist as a writer, that when you said that you could never believe them, You didn't mean that other people
not
couldn't.
At all. That's the point. But I meant that as far as I was concerned, they had no particular relevance to a belated passion for the Christian religion. I mean, if you take a thing like the Trinity, you see. Well, I can see in a sort of way that this kind of, you know, this three in one in three has a point, but it would never kind of seem to me to be of particular significance.
Well, of course, it would be of considerable significance to someone whose attachment to Christianity was in part a reflection of his belief in its authority.
Absolutely.
In other words, if God lives, then this is, let's say, an additional reason for doing his will. Otherwise, if you simply depend on the autonomy of the morality of the Bible.
I'm not concerned with its autonomy. I'm only saying that I agree with you absolutely that the point of the whole thing is God. But I can't sort of see that one's relations with God or one's understanding with God, such as they are affected in any way by the notion of the Trinity, as far as I'm concerned. But I'm quite sure that to a lot of other people they are.
Well, presumably, though, your respect for Christ, your respect for Christ is in some way conditioned by the question of whether or not he was telling the truth when he called himself divine, right?
Oh,
or
yes.
Or might that just have been bad reporting?
Well, no, it might very easily have been bad reporting in point of fact, but I'm sure Christ was divine, and I'm sure that he was conscious of being divine. But not in a...
Sorry to interrupt. Mr. Buckley and his guest, Malcolm Muggeridge, will be back after this message.
From the position which is God in the Christian sense.
In the dogmatic sense, no. No.
But I want you to be clearly understood. You don't mean that he was divine in the sense that Shakespeare was divine?
No, not at all. I mean that he had a unique message in explaining relations between man and God, and in explaining what human life was really about. But the idea of him as a son of God, in a particular sense, is something that, again, means nothing to me.
And does it mean nothing to you, or to you representing a particular position, or do you mean you individually? I remember the Wyndham Lewis, at one point commenting in a short story on the development of British socialism, predicted that the Christianity within it would someday soon evaporate, leaving it a purely secular doctrine.
And to a great extent, this has happened. He was quite right. He was a very perceptive man, Wyndham Lewis, in many, many ways. And I think he was absolutely right about that.
Right. So would you say, as somebody said on a program, a Cardinal Heenan, as a matter of fact, that England is full of pagans? He put it rather carefully. He said, although we don't use the word because it's an offensive kind of word to use, this country is full of pagans. It seems odd to say that. He's not going to say something, but say it on TV with you.
Yes.
This country is full of people who know as little about God as the so-called heathens that you mentioned.
Well, it's absolutely true.
This is true. And now, why is it? Why do the Beatles have to go to mysterious India to get their kicks?
Oh, well, this is another thing. I had a conversation with that old Maharishi on the radio, you know. So I saw
that. Did you die of ennui?
No, I didn't die of ennui, but I felt that he was just a delectable old Hindu con man, you know. He had a splendid idea, which is a very shrewd idea, which is exactly what everybody wants to hear today. Mm-hmm. That is to say, he said, if you will do certain spiritual exercises for 20 minutes in the morning and 20 minutes in the evening,
you develop your moral tone.
And it doesn't matter what you do in between.
Yeah.
This was exactly sort of made to measure for this age, you see, and naturally attracted the Beatles.
Well, are you able to account for the reason for the disappearance of religion, of Christian religion, as a real force in England, and as something that is consulted by its politicians in the same sense that, for instance, Gladstone consulted Christianity when he actually had vexing moral questions? Or is that considered terribly naive?
It's a bit naive.
Yeah.
A bit naive.
I say, is it considered naive?
Yes, I think it could legitimately...
I didn't ask whether it was.
No, it could be considered a bit naive. But you say, why has the Christian religion ceased to play, now is playing a very insignificant part in our national life and in the lives of people, particularly young people? I guess. You probably wouldn't find more than one or two among all this lot who would say they were Christians.
You might be surprised. I know one, but...
Might. I might be. But, I mean, in general, if you picked just a group of students at random, you would find a very small sprinkling who would say they were Christians. Why has this happened? Well, I think it's happened for two reasons. One is that from Darwin, particularly onward, the intellectual climate of England was utopian. In other words, it promoted and believed in a kingdom of heaven on earth. And that if people are induced to believe in a kingdom of heaven on earth, of course, they don't believe in a kingdom of heaven in heaven because it's not needed. The church, our church anyway, and now your church belatedly is going the same way with, I'm sure, utterly ruinous consequences. Our church fell in with this and moved away from the idea of a kingdom of heaven in heaven towards the idea of a kingdom of heaven on earth. Now the kingdom of heaven on earth hasn't come. Because it never does. Mm-hmm. And if you ask me why the Beatles have gone after my old delectable Hindu con man, it is because of this. It's because the various prospectuses that have been issued at different times over the last century or so for a kingdom of heaven on earth have all been duds.
Yes. Well, but wouldn't you think under the circumstances, especially insofar as you succeed in establishing a rational correlation, that the failure to utopianize our world would bring people back to a quest for Christianity?
Not if the ostensible representatives of the Christian religion have themselves underwritten the phony prospectuses. And this is precisely what's happened.
Well,
you see my point?
I certainly see your point. I certainly see your point. And there, as you know, Some scholars talk about the Gnostic heresy, the immanentizing of the eschaton, and so on and so forth. And I think it's unquestionably true that to the extent that one seeks to utopianize the world, one loses the kind of detachment that makes spiritual life possible. But just as, for instance, in America, and I understand to a certain extent here, the failures of liberalism have stimulated the intelligence. So the people are looking elsewhere for other means to achieve highly desirable goals. Why is it that the native energy of English intellectuals, of English students, doesn't turn to Christianity, Bevanism having failed?
Well, Bill, because the people, the only people they could turn to are for the most part people who were holding on to Bevan's coattails.
Yeah, well, the Bible exists.
Oh, yes, the Gospels exist, and this is my point. This is where I stand.
We must interrupt Mr. Buckley and his distinguished guest, Malcolm Muggeridge, for a moment. We'll be back after this message.
Have you ever seen that?
The clergy, particularly.
Oh, come on.
Oh, yes, Bill, I assure you. The ones who really go for me and kick me are the clergy. Because to say they consider that if you... if you speak of Christianity as it's presented in the Gospels, this is, they say, pessimistic. Pessimistic. You see, I think it's the most insanely optimistic proposition that you can possibly put before men, that such miserably inadequate creatures as we are could aspire to understanding of God. Fantastically optimistic. But they won't have that because they're so caught up with sort of being anti-apartheid and anti-Vietnam and freedom marching and all that rot, you see, which has absorbed the whole energies of the Christian church in this country.
Yes, yes, but you're surely not contending, are you?
You hear these young people.
Strong reaction. Yes, I want to hear from them in just
yes,
a second.
None.
But you're not contending, are you, that the only proper attitude for... a Christian, left or right, is one of such detachment from his society that as to make it sort of impure to attempt reform in
the
sense.
No, I'm not. Not at all. Not at all. I think he should be a good and enlightened citizen. But I think that the
What's an example of something that he shouldn't do that is, for instance, being backed by one of your bishops or somebody?
I'll tell you exactly. I mean, if he identifies himself with a particular earthly cause, as very large numbers of Anglican clergymen identify themselves, for instance, with the Labour Party, you see, they said that we as Christians, we have an amusing figure called Lord Soper, who's a Methodist minister, now called Lord Soper. He's been saying this for years, you see, in various television programs that I have christened Soper Opera, you know, because they are dominated by him. Now, the point is, he has been saying for years that the Labour Party represents the highest Christian aspiration. There's a catch in this. The Labour Party gets into power. And then he's stuck with Wilson, and he's got to say that Wilson represents the highest Christian aspiration, and that, believe me, is hard sledding.
Yeah. That's what we call incredible.
Yes.
Yeah.
But you see my point. You see, I'm saying that that contrary to what has been the practice and indeed dynamic of the church in the last century, that to identify Christian hopes with an earthly cause, however ostensibly noble, is disastrous, because all earthly causes end in total disappointment. For instance, supposing you take the classic case which is present in all our minds, the question of apartheid in South Africa. This is for us a very important issue. Now, no Christian could possibly support apartheid. Apartheid is a vile thing. Apartheid is setting between man and man an unbreakable barrier, you see. So it's vile. But for Christians to support movements directed against apartheid simply means that in the end they will be supporting the replacement of the present white gangsters who rule South Africa by black gangsters. And there'll be very little in it.
Well, I think this is interesting political speculation, and with some of it I'm sympathetic, but I think that I think it's over dogmatic when you say no Christian could support apartheid in South Africa. My answer is some Christians do.
So they're not Christians.
No, well, but this gives you a rather plenipotentiary rights to excommunicate.
Well, I say that no Christian could support apartheid, but I also say that no Christian should identify himself with any political movement against apartheid.
Yeah, qua Christian.
Yes.
Qua Christian.
Qua Christian. As a citizen,
but you
of course.
Just did, in a way, it seems to me, because if anybody who supports apartheid is vile, then presumably a Christian seeking not to be vile should oppose apartheid.
He should disengage himself from it, which certain very good Christians in South Africa have, and they are the people like Alan Payton. Yeah. They're the people I admire there. They are Christians, and they've said we can't have anything to do with it.
Well, I admire him ethically, not at all politically. I mean, he belongs to the Liberal Party instead of the Progressive Party.
He's got a taint of liberalism in his...
No, the Liberal Party in the one man, one vote sense,
yes.
Which practically nobody belongs to in South Africa, including Mrs. Sussman or any of those people. Yeah. However...
That's a separate point.
I think your generic point is the most interesting, which is why I think it might be unwise for us to go into the whole South African situation.
Right.
Your generic position is that nobody should say, I believe that all Christians ought to join this political movement as another. All right.
Or to identify or to speculate with the Christian faith on any earthly movement or hope.
That's right.
We
don't want any fusion.
No.
That's right.
You're
against a Christian socialist parties or Christian democratic parties.
I think it's terrible. Yeah. Because
however,
these are the things that discredit Christianity.
I agree. However, wouldn't it be perfectly proper, supposing that we lived in Germany during the days of Hitler, to say it is the duty of all Christians to oppose Adolf Hitler?
Well, of course, it's the duty of all Christians to oppose Nazism.
Yeah.
But there again, if the Christian church had identified itself, insofar as it did, with specific movements, political movements, this could only damage it. Let's go further back. Let's think of the time when Christ was alive in Judea. Now, if Christ had identified himself with Jewish nationalism, which must have been quite a considerable temptation in point of fact, it would there never would have been a Christian religion or a Christian church.
Well, the trouble is you've got metaphysical difficulties.
Sorry to interrupt. We'll be right back.
Made mistakes, you see, perfectly easily. I mean, the point is, let's take it even simpler. Let's take what is to me always the most fascinating thing, that temptation in the wilderness.
Yes.
When the devil offered Christ the kingdoms of the earth, you see. Now, he wouldn't take them, of course. Interestingly enough, that the kingdoms of the earth should be in the devil's gift, mm-hmm. which I cordially approve of, cordially agree with. Now,
he never died at his proprietorship.
Never. Mm-hmm. Now, you see, from the point of view of the sort of Anglicans and other clergymen and so on in this country that I'm talking about, that was an act of madness. Christ should have accepted the kingdoms of the earth, and he should have set up excellent socialist, equalitarian, forward-looking, welfare-creating governments in them. Mm-hmm. And then mankind would have lived happily ever after. That's the view of the clergy today. But of course, I think Christ was absolutely right. Because I think that if you could establish a kingdom on the earth that was any good, then human life would be so insignificant, so tenth rate, that it wouldn't be worth living.
Yes,
you see my point?
I certainly do. I certainly do. And we know, at least Christ made it explicit, that his kingdom was not of this
not
world.
Not of this world.
But, sometimes it seems to me, in the ferocity with which we attack utopianism, we give the impression, I say now we because I haven't found anything that you've said that an American conservative would disagree with, sometimes it seems to me that we give the impression that we are against the use of political reason, in the same sense that your Professor Oakeshott is so opposed to rationalism that he sometimes makes it sound as though only unintelligent decisions are wise. Now,
this is stupid.
What, in point of fact, since one needs in a society to organize its political resources for good, what would have been the proper way for Christians, qua Christians, to behave in Germany during the early 30s?
Well, I think that a Christian, I think that Pastor Bonhoeffer behaved in a perfect way.
Martyrdom.
Yes. And martyrdom of a particular, it's a sticky wicket, but it's martyrdom of a particularly sublime kind, you see. Pastor Bonhoeffer was not in any bogus underground movement or League of Free Men or any rot like that. Mm-hmm. He was a Christian, and as a Christian, he could have nothing to do with the Nazis. As a Christian, he was the enemy of the Nazis. As a Christian, he was put in prison, and as a Christian, he was killed. And this is my perfect, this is to me a perfect example, an example that I cherish because I read in his letters that somebody who remembered him being in that camp when he was taken away to be executed, he said, this guard said that he was the only happy man in the place, you see, and that as he went away, he said, you think it's an end, but it's a beginning. Mm-hmm. That's Christianity, you see. And I think that, sorry?
Was there a, I think there was a sort of a frantic question there, was there? Do you want to ask a question?
Anyway, that you ask me what would be a Christian attitude to evil.
Yes, but I don't think that's a satisfactory answer for the reason that I would suppose that a martyr has to be graced before he can come through with exertions that heroic. But take non-heroes, like non-saints, like you and me, maybe.
Yes, very much so, very much so.
We'd just soon not be executed if we can absolutely get away with it.
Well, I think that might be so.
Therefore, how can one take Christianity and infuse it into politics with enough precautions to prevent happening what you and I agree oughtn't to happen?
I think the only way to do it is the way we're told to do it in the Gospels, and that is to say, to be Christians. If we are Christians in the sense that we are instructed, then in our capacity as citizens, we shall behave in an enlightened and humane and good way. If we are not Christians, we shall not. if we identify our Christianity with any form of organization or activity, if we identify Christianity with it, that is disastrous to our Christianity.
Yeah.
You see? In other words, if we had lived in Nazi Germany, the highest thing would be like Bonhoeffer, to be killed.
Yeah.
Because there's an evil thing there, and the best thing to do to an evil thing is to be destroyed by it. Then you damage it most effectively. Secondly, we would have been, as Christians, we would have been citizens who would have been hostile to the Nazis.
We'd have joined the opposition in whatever form.
Yes, but not qua Christians.
Yeah.
You see what I mean? Qua good citizens. Like old Adenauer, for instance. He was a Christian of a sort, and he went, I mean, he was, towards the end of the war, he got into trouble with the authorities and so on. He lived for a time in a monastery during the period, and he emerged to be a post-war leader of Germany. But the point is that you may or may not admire that career.
I do admire it.
You do admire it. Other people might not admire it. I think he was a remarkable old fellow.
Yeah.
But the point is that if you had, I mean, his Christianity lay not in what he did or the causes he espoused or the party he founded. It lay in so far as he inwardly was a good man and behaved in a good way. And there is this distinction which is almost lost in the crazy view of Christianity which exists in this country.
Yeah, he served as a paradigm.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, but is it also true that the Christians should thirst for justice? And under the circumstances should exert themselves.
But they thirst for justice knowing there can never be any justice.
Well, there can never be satisfactory justice.
No, that's it. And that's
justice.
Very important.
Yeah.
You see, because again, our SOPAs say that if only you'll sort of vote for that man and set up that particular sort of institution, there will be justice. Mm-hmm. There will never be justice. There can't ever be justice. And the first thing the Christian must know is that there can't be. Knowing that, he may be able to make justice a little better because he knows that.
I agree.
Sorry to interrupt. We'll be back after this message.
Of the left as opposed to, let's say, the right, or would you say that this is now so unusual that it's just individuals who embrace that position, that they tend not to come either from the right or from the left?
I suspect that that is so. I suspect that that is so. And that therefore my observation, which you began this talk, that I consider myself a man on the left, gets more and more a sort of theoretical one.
Yeah.
And bears less and less relationship to any kind
actualities,
of setup, political setup or otherwise. I was very gratified and proud to learn unofficially in the BBC that I was on the sort of anathema list of all three parties.
Mm-hmm.
You know, most people, they have a sort of, the party machines say that certain people may appear, you know, on their behalf. And I was the only person who was on the anathema list for all three, which I would like to put on my tombstone.
Well, but you don't, your attraction to a nonconformism is more than attraction. I think you also said once that that the pilgrim in Pilgrim's Progress was put in prison because he was naturally, as all good men are, a nonconformist. Mm. Now, is it good
in
to be a nonconformist?
In Vanity Fair.
No, in Pilgrim's Progress.
Yes, but in Vanity Fair, it was in Vanity Fair that he was arrested.
Oh, yes, that's right, yeah, sure.
But he was hurrying through. He wasn't trying to set up a cooperative store there or anything like that.
Yes.
Or to get elected to the borough council of Vanity Fair. Yeah. He was wanted to get the hell out of the place.
Well, do you say that it's always good to be a nonconformist because you believe that almost necessarily the establishment or the institutions are going to embody that which is the worst rather than the best of humankind, that under the circumstances almost necessarily dissent is the proper relationship towards one society?
Well, I think towards power, yes.
Power.
Yes, I mean, power is the devil.
Yeah.
And as we said just now, the devil has power in his gift. Mm-hmm. And if men have power, it's been given them by the devil, not by God, mm-hmm. because God doesn't traffic in power. Mm-hmm. Therefore, you can make a fair assumption that people in power are people to be disagreed with.
Well, I think that people in power are people to be criticized.
It comes the same.
But I should think that, for instance, as regards a recent challenges, recent crises that I'm familiar with, I'd go for authority. For instance, I could write, I think, an extensive book of criticism of Mr. Johnson, but as regards Mr. Johnson over against most of his critics in the United States, I'm for Johnson, who has the power.
Yeah, but that is as a citizen, not as a Christian.
Well, you weren't talking in a specifically Christian context.
No, I wasn't, but I was saying that power is evil. And when I say things evil, I'm talking in a Christian context, you see. But of course, it's evil, but you still have to make terms with it of some sort. And in making terms with it,
sometimes you have to defend it, too.
You might even.
Yeah.
And you may legitimately say that that is a less abhorrent form of it than that. Mm-hmm. You see, that is a legitimate thing as a citizen. But always in the back of your mind is the knowledge that power is evil.
Right, right. And you must always stand aside critically and challenge its pretensions, its vanities.
And the moment that you land yourself in the position of saying, I'm with that because it's authority, and it's a very easy position to get into almost by accident, then you're done. Then you're doomed.
Well, now here I guess I will have to dissociate from that, because it seems to me that the distinctive sin intellectually these days is a sin of pride, of hubris, and that the genuinely humble person tends to look for and accept an authority outside himself. Now, this isn't an authority that got 51% of the vote in yesterday's election.
No.
I mean something that for some people they call it the great tradition.
Those are phony words.
Eliot called it the democracy of the dead.
Yes.
And some people would find it, of course, in the spiritual life, in the spiritual. No, I don't think they're completely phony.
Largely.
But I think it's a self-abnegation is, I think, a virtue.
Absolutely vital, but there's only one way to achieve humility, and that's in relation to God, not in relation to power.
No, also in relation to other people.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, also in relation to other people.
But never in relation to power. Power's an addiction.
No, we were talking about authority now.
Well, authority and power are virtually the same thing, and that's an addiction. Those men are junkies.
I don't think that Edmund Burke had any power, but I think he has considerable authority. He does over my life. If I find myself disagreeing with Burke, I tend to lie down till I get over it.
It doesn't worry me, Bill.
Because you haven't esteem for him.
I don't say that
I'm completely obedient or wannabe. But I say that people like Burke and Johnson and here and there Jefferson and Lincoln and such are people who speak to me.
Johnson,
and
yes.
And that if I find myself completely athwart what I understand to be the residue of those great minds, I tend to think there's something wrong with me rather than vice versa.
Well, give me Johnson, but not Burke, if you don't mind.
Yeah.
I mean, Johnson, I'll go with you. And I think Johnson, of all Englishmen, was the one who expressed to me most cogently and admirably these two sort of sides of us, the mystic and the necessity to make terms with authority and to accept authority as a necessity.
Yeah, yeah. Well, would you say that Johnson was correct when he said that man is seldom so innocently engaged as when in pursuit of money?
Well, I think he was making a joke there.
You do?
You see, I think that Johnson, you know, made many more jokes than people think. And that some of those remarks, I bet you anything that was meant to be funny.
I don't think so, because he agreed with the economics of Adam Smith.
Well, he might have. But I don't think he thought he was innocently. See, otherwise he was so, going back to Burke, it's rather interesting. He was so profoundly shocked by the fact that Burke had accumulated a lot of money. Do you remember when he went to see his estate?
Well, he
and he thought, where's that come from?
Richer than he, because he was
and
so
also,
poor.
He was very poor, but being poor, he gave away 2/3 of his income. Actually, you know, he had 300 a year as a pension.
2/3 of Chesterfield's income?
Well, the government.
I see.
No, it wasn't the Chesterfield. He wouldn't have accepted a penny from that louse.
Well, not after he turned him down.
No. It was from the government. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And he accepted it like sort of swallowing medicine, but he did accept it. And he only kept 100. He gave away 200.
I think there were some questions, and I'm sorry. Yes, sir.
To come back to Christianity, St. Paul, when defending the resurrection, said, if Christ did not rise from the dead, then we are of all men to be most pitied. Could you comment on this, please?
Yes, certainly. I'm absolutely sure that Christ did rise from the dead, in the sense that Christ is alive now, you see? And the proof of that is that the Christian gospel, the words he spoke, the things he stood for, are in a quite unique manner living and relevant now. If you ask me whether the business about the stone and the apparitions and all those things, whether they are objectively and historically true, I bow the head and say, I don't know. You know.
You don't any longer find them incredible?
I'm not interested in them, you see. But I am enormously interested in the fact that this man died, and that despite his death, he remains alive. Now, this hasn't happened to anybody else who lived in the world. I mean, Socrates died in very noble circumstances and very movingly, but he doesn't remain alive.
But on what authority do you say, I believe this part of the Bible, but I don't believe that part?
Well, what part are you suggesting I don't believe?
Well, things like the resurrection, the virgin birth.
Well, I don't say that I don't believe them. I say that they have their meaning to me personally, and I can only say that. I mean, I can't, I don't think there's any, I don't believe that you can present a man with a sort of list of things.
We'll be back very shortly.
Or you're not a Christian. I don't think that is so, you see? And therefore, with all humility, I would claim to be a Christian.
Yes, but you're fighting another of your losing battles, actually, Mr. Muggeridge, by trying to encourage us to believe in the New Testament and the stories which you so much admire, and to base our present views upon the New Testament, such as our views about apartheid, when in fact these have no relevance today. This is the reason why modern youth does not believe. It's because the church has lost its administrative power. We no longer have faith in its creed. We no longer have faith in its administration.
Isn't that, you're echoing my very words, dear boy. You're echoing my very words.
No, I'm saying we no longer want to go to the New Testament. This is why we go to India.
Well, if you don't want to go, don't go. But I tell you that if you go, you'll find it's very well worthwhile.
I'm telling you, we're trying to trying a new experience, which a lot of people have found far more satisfying and have far better results for it.
What sort of experience?
The experience of meditation. The experience which there's a definite satisfaction which one can get, which is permanent and obvious.
Well, I'm delighted if you feel that. I wish you nothing but well. But, I mean, the point is that you can't correspondingly persuade me that because, as I am the very first to agree with you, the Anglican Church is a completely derisory organization, you can't persuade me that I'm not entitled to say that I think there is more to be found in the Gospels and New Testament. You don't want to go there, don't go there. Go to the Maharishi.
I'm not deriding the church, but
no.
I'm...
I am deriding it.
Yes, you've been deriding
it. I'm deriding it like hell.
deride the Bible, which
no, I don't deride. I haven't derided the Bible. I love the Bible, especially.
But you can't separate the two. If
yes,
you're a
I
Christian.
Can. I can separate the Bible from the Anglican Church. At least I hope I can.
Would you pass the microphone back? This lady has a.
I don't think it makes any difference whether you're the Beatles or your con men or to the church as your con men, and I think that you might as well identify yourself with a worthy cause on earth as to believe in some fantasy in heaven which you have no proof of.
Very well, very well, very well. As long as you're quite sure that you've got a worthy cause, and as long as you're quite sure the other's a fantasy.
Isn't this why Webb and the Shavians stood out at the beginning of the century? Because
do you have a mic? Because nobody's hearing you if you don't.
Is this not why the Webbs and Shaw stood out against your form of Christianity at the turn of the century?
Well, the three cases are so dissimilar, so utterly different. Mr. and Mrs. Webb and Bernard Shaw are so completely. Mrs. Webb was a frustrated mystic. She was a woman who said to me towards the end of her life that prayer had been the one thing that had meant anything to her, you see.
But she was a Christian that went out and worked.
Well, imagine?
And they eventually became associated with parties.
Yes, to her, with the most disastrous consequences.
But alternatively, they were essentially good people, were
they? They were good people, but they
not
were
unlike
disastrous.
Your dear Mr. Ardenau.
I didn't say he was a devil. That's a very cheap 10th-rate crack, my boy. And I don't want to listen to you anymore.
Wow.
He was not my dear. He's not my dear Dr. Ardenau. I said the old boy had a remarkable career. If that's saying he's dear, you see, this is the way you're distorting.
I don't think I am distorting.
Well, you are. I didn't say he was dear.
I think...
Perhaps you think he's dead.
Well, that's his inference, right?
But it's a false inference.
Call him my dear. I don't mind at all.
No.
I'm very sorry.
I would guess this right now. I don't know you very well, and I really didn't know I'd not very well, but I would guess he was probably brighter than you. I would guess probably that he took more risks with the Nazis opposing them than I would guess you have, or maybe even will. So under the circumstances, it seems to me, if we're going to talk about who's dear and who's not, I will sight unseen, sight
No, but the word dear, Bill, is a word, you know, you must know in this country, sort of slipped in, you see, to give the impression that I adulate honor. I don't adulate Adenauer any more than I adulate de Gaulle or anybody else. I just see him as part of the scene, the historical scene in the post-war years. That's all.
Yeah. Well, but is it not fair to say that an awful lot of people, and they tend to be especially young people, who find nothing sort of odd in idolizing John Lemon. Find it extremely odd to idolize somebody who's been idolized by perhaps the finest minds in the history of the world. Is there anybody living in England today who is as bright as John Henry Newman? Or brighter than Chesterton or C.S. Lewis? Since when did people who believe in these fantasies become intellectually underprivileged? Make those demonstrations.
He's got something.
Yes.
May I return, please, Mr. Muggeridge, to your philosophy, your Christian philosophy, perhaps, as you outlined it briefly a moment ago.
Scarcely philosophy is an excessive word.
Your idea of Christianity. Halting Christian faith
is how I describe it.
Defaulting Christian faith.
Halting Christian faith.
I beg your pardon. Would it not be true to say that with your notion of Christian detachment from perhaps worldly things, which presumably would include human beings being earthly things?
No. Wrong.
Wrong?
Wrong.
Well,
nothing like that in Christianity. On the contrary, the essence of Christianity, if you remember the two great commandments that Christ gave us, were to love God and love our fellows. You can't say that if we love our fellows, if we regard our fellows as a human family with a Father in heaven, that we're detaching ourselves from them. In fact, I would say that in our civilization, all that has ameliorated the relations between man and man through those centuries has in fact been the Christian religion.
I would say that. Because it calls for that kind of commitment.
Our time has run out. We want to thank Mr. Buckley and his guest, Malcolm Muggeridge, and the students from University College and Surrey University.